and welcome to Nintendo Voice Chat presents Talk of the Kingdom. I still can't believe we get to call it that. I'm your host, Brian Altano, along with my incredible crew of Zelda obsessives, Kat Bailey, Per Schneider, Seth Macy, and Brendan Graeber. Hi, everybody.
Hello.
Hello, hey. Brian.
All right, so the game is out. We've been playing it for a week. I can't wait to get into our stories. I assume we all love it. That's why we're here, right? No haters here today. This week on Tears of the Kingdom, we're breaking down the best and most important side quests that you should definitely do first. Then we're taking a look at the craziest, most innovative fan inventions that people are making. Then we'll be talking about how people are torturing Koroks and just how we feel about that. I'm mixed on it. Plus, we'll be talking about amiibo integration with the world's most obsessed amiibo collector, Per Schneider. But first, Tears of the Kingdom has been out for a week. How's everybody feeling about it? I personally will say, to kick things off, that how dare this show pull me away from playing the game today.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Hold on, Kat. There's something in your ear. Oh.
Is that an amiibo? That's the biggest amiibo you could have pulled from her. I guess I may have made a mistake.
Guardian.
The Guardian.
Maybe the illusion was broken by that.
Kat, let's start with you. You know, you've been a Zelda fan your entire life. How's this first week been for you?
My entire life? Okay, I'm going to say that this game definitely has its hooks in me.
Okay.
And I'm excited to be playing it on the reg. I'm frankly a little upset that I'm not playing it right now.
See?
Having said that.
Here we go.
Let's put some respect on Breath of the Wild's name. Let's stop calling it a beta for Tears of the Kingdom. I don't think that's it at all. I think it's a wildly different game. Tears of the Kingdom is a giant toy box. Mm-hmm. And I have to say, I didn't grow up with Minecraft, and I didn't like shop class. So in that respect, like, I sort of feel like I'm not using all of the things that they put in to the maximum extent. I tend to walk past all of the things that I can use to build vehicles. I'm not that excited to do it.
Yeah.
I'm excited to play it in a fairly straightforward manner. I do like the new abilities. They're very cool.
Mm-hmm.
I think that Breath of the Wild had more of an atmosphere to it. I mean, you were surviving in a desolated world. There were the guardians that were chasing you around. And yes, it was more limited, but I think that there is something to be said for being more limited rather than going crazy. This game is gigantic.
Yes.
I cannot believe it. It's ridiculous. And so I'm enjoying it on its own terms.
Right.
And I think it's really good, and I like the darkness to it. And the sheer scope just constantly has me in awe. But I also think it's a very different game.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm thinking of it in those terms. And I think it says a lot about Tears of the Kingdom that it can win me over, even though its core conceit is not my favorite thing in a video game.
Fair. Yeah. I mean, there is a heavy emphasis on building stuff. And if that's not something you want to do, or something that Per is slowly introducing amiibo throughout the show on the desk.
One.
What are you talking about?
And he owns all of them. So I'm worried how crowded this desk is going to collapse under the weight of plastic scannable toys by the end of this episode. I'm in the same boat, Kat. I love the game, but I'm going by those little, you know, IKEA shops that are spread all over the place.
That's a good way to put it.
Because I know that, like, I could spend 20 minutes building a car that will explode, or I can just run. So we'll get into some of the crazier fan creations later on. Per, how's your first week with the game been?
Oh, man. I didn't get to play it before launch. I saw somebody play it, and it was honestly torture to have to wait till launch day. Mm-hmm. And, I preloaded it, and then my kids said, "What? We want to preload it." So we had four copies ready at launch, and then recreated the scene when Breath of the Wild came out, where everybody's sitting on the couch playing together. And we had my daughter FaceTiming in from Tokyo. And
oh, my God.
All playing together. Wow. And people were sharing discoveries, and it was just a really wonderful moment. I think to your point on Breath of the Wild, Breath of the Wild is its own game. But what I think is so remarkable about Tears of the Kingdom is how it feels the way it feels and it works the way it works because Breath of the Wild existed.
Yeah.
We learned a lot of things about how this world works and the things you could do. And you learned, oh, I can pick up magnetic things and I can, you know, hit things and make them fly into the air. And then this game just goes, okay, all those tools are gone. Uh-huh. The world is similar, but time has passed, and you'll often have this Gandalf moment where you go, I have no memory of this place, right? Like, you're in a familiar place, but it's different.
Yeah.
And then you're asked to solve the problems differently. And in some cases, it almost feels like you're cheating. Mm-hmm. Because, like, you worked so hard in Breath of the Wild to solve a certain puzzle, and in this game you go broom, and you go through the ceiling, you're like, I don't care about that anymore.
Right.
And I just think that feeling is just so cool of having to like learn these new tools and then solve things in an unorthodox way. And that's why I think this game works so well, is because Breath of the Wild was so great and established this language. Mm-hmm. And then secondly, there is a really different vibe here, because when you're jumping, you know, out of the sky, and you're following into a hole in the ground, and you hear like Boromir's horn like blow as you fall into the depths, you're like, I'm in trouble. Like, yeah. There's this sort of oppressive, weird netherworld, like upside down feel to the underground that just gives this game a completely different flavor. Where some people may go, I don't want to go there.
Yeah,
I'm just going to stay up.
I've spent most of or significantly more time in the depths than I have in the sky. And I did I did not anticipate that going in, but it's just like, extremely punishing, and, you know, just kind of Miyazaki as heck down there. Like, there's poison swamps everywhere, and you lose hearts, you know, semi-permanently. And for all the risk, there's reward, there's treasures, there's you clearing out that fog of war sort of is an incredible feeling. And just seeing how massive that map is, finding just how bleak and oppressive and miserable and dark and scary it is down there, fighting super evil versions of enemies that live above. I've really, really gravitated towards that part of the game, and I did not anticipate that. We didn't know about it going in, but I thought I'd spend so much time in the sky, and I'm not really interested in being in the sky so much. I want to go down in the depths.
But even the sky, you know, there, it's obviously very sparsely populated with islands and things. And my first issue with the game was, like, I'm having a hard time remembering if I've been to these little sky islands and what I've done. But they're really smart with how they place the shrines, right? Yeah. Like, you may, I'll be careful not to spoil sections of the game. You'll find something in the sky and you can't get in, mm-hmm. but the game goes, but there's a shrine. And not only are you getting the reward of being able to do a cool little puzzle dungeon, right. and we could talk a little bit more about that, like solving it in a way where you as a player often feel like, I'm the only person in the world who solved this dungeon this way. Mm-hmm. I did it in a really terrible way that I don't want to tell anybody about, right? Like, but you get the reward of that puzzle dungeon, and then you get a map marker that you can instantly warp to. Mm-hmm. So you remember, oh, I got to come back then. You place your little sticker on the map. I just think the gameplay loop and the setup of this game, it's so impressive and it's so fun. And I never get where I want to go because there's so many things to do, and the side quests are actually interesting. It's got a little Majora's Mask-like side quests in the towns, right?
Yep.
And then I think, who were the people who bug tested this game, and how many decades have they been working on this game?
I don't understand it.
It's crazy.
I don't understand it. You can go outside of the shrines, where, like, sometimes you're limited by your Zonai devices, but you can go into any part of any room anywhere in the world. I don't understand that. Like, you could go. I was in a room and I was like, there's something interesting up in that corner there, but I don't think they want me to go there. But I just built like a device that brought me up there, and I was banging my head against the ceiling and then ascended through it and ended up somewhere else. And I'm like, how do you test that? I cannot understand it.
The purity of that, you can see also the evolution of their game design, because I bet you that game for the longest time did not have coordinates markers under its map, the little thing. And then they started playing with 3D space, and they're like, well, it's like Link to the Past in the Light and the Dark World. There's this one moment in Link to the Past that I loved, spoiler for a very old game, where there's a heart container up on a ledge, and the way to get it is to travel through time, where, you know, a piece of that mountain doesn't exist. You go there, you travel back, and then you're on top of the mountain. And this game does this all the time, where, like, a locked room or a portion of the cave, you can just go through the ceiling and access it. It's just so cool. Mm-hmm. And the coordinates make it now possible to actually plan and test it, you know?
I was comparing it to Red Dead Redemption 2, mm-hmm. a game where is ostensibly a big sandbox, but I was trying to do a lot of different things, like, I don't know, rob a bank or mess around with the train mechanics. And I was constantly felt like I was bumping into an invisible wall. And ooh, this yeah. is the case for a lot of open world games where the mechanics just don't allow you to do a lot of the things that you actually want yep. to do. And Tears of the Kingdom, it often feels like whatever dumb idea I have, I'm probably going to be able to make it work. And that mm-hmm. is a really cool and liberating feeling.
Yeah.
Remember Horizon Zero Dawn, right? Where she could leap through the air and shoot arrows into giant robots and just be like badass and kick ass, and but she can't hop this little fence.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Like, that is so immersion breaking, but we kind of got used to the language of video games. Like, that door can't be opened, that door can be opened. We mm-hmm. kind of learned it over time to ignore the things that would work in the real world. And somehow in this game, like, it just all works.
I mean, we used to call it, I would call it Skyrimming up a mountain, right? Yeah. Which is like not a real... Yeah, just like it, you're not supposed to. And Horizon had a lot of that too, where you're like, I don't think I'm supposed to be here, but I'm going to go up it anyway. Seth, yes. I know how excited you were for this game. Having you on the episodes in the last few weeks, where people who have played the game get to talk to you about it, as you just kind of sat there with your mouth open,
a gape.
Yeah, yeah. I'll let you say that word. I didn't want to do it. Agape. How are you liking it?
Well, similar to Cat, I want to give a shout out to Breath of the Wild, which was my all-time favorite game. And I sort of felt some of the same things, Cat, that you described when I first started, like that I missed from Breath of the Wild, that feeling of like the danger when you first see a guardian and it's like way across an open field and it's just like crawling around and you're like, I don't think I should be there. And I wasn't sold 100% on Tears of the Kingdom as far as a successor to Breath of the Wild. I was like, man, this is an incredible game, what an achievement, but I don't know. And then I did my first dungeon and I was like, oh okay, yeah, this is the best game ever made, it's the best Zelda game ever made, I don't want to stop playing it. I'm very upset most of the day that I'm at work, not because of work, but because I'm not playing this game. I can hear my oldest playing it in his room right now.
Can I tell you a quick secret, Seth? Do you have a bunch of IGN employees on your friends list on Switch?
Actually, I don't.
Okay, yeah, because that's the quickest way to find out that everyone you work with is playing this game yep. during the day. Everyone. Like, I don't know if they know about airplane mode, but like, if when you turn that thing on, it just goes bing, 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 and you get just all the people in all these apartments. People I'm in meetings with, but I'm on there too, so it's like, I can't yeah. judge, right?
On like, launch day, the pop-up wouldn't stop.
Oh my God.
It was like, blink, blink, blink.
I was going to say, the people that are on my friends list, yeah. that first day I'm playing it and I see somebody like log on and they're playing Mario Kart. I'm like, what is your deal, guy? And then somebody comes on, they're playing Splatoon. I'm like, get with the program. And then by Tuesday, because I know that a lot of people's games didn't actually arrive if they
right.
were.
Yeah.
And by Tuesday, it has been nothing but every single person on my friends list, Tears of the Kingdom, Tears of the Kingdom, Tears of the Kingdom. And it's incredible.
I saw somebody playing like Nintendo Switch Online and
just slap it out of their hands.
Yeah, and it just reminded me of that scene in Charlie and the Chocolate Factory where like all the kids in class are like, I bought 100 candy bars. And they're like, what about you, Charlie? And he's like, one. And the teacher's like, one?
One Wookabat?
What?
Yeah.
Like, this is a global. Yeah, no, it's been wonderful to see. Brendan, you've probably played more hours than everyone here combined times three, maybe? Like, you're helping to head up our guide coverage, which has been incredible to see. Amazing. Just to watch that grow. How many Korok seeds have you found? Like, I don't even know where to start with you. Like,
I'm like that Steam review you see where it says like 150 hours played. Yeah. It's okay. But in truth, like, I've spent my time doing everything and also nothing at the same time.
Right.
I think I spent the first few hours trying to find the main boss, mm-hmm. like Ganon, just go fight him early. And then I did everything except the main quest for like the next 40 hours and then realized I should probably see what the main story is like and then beeline that and then reload an earlier save to do other fun stuff. And like the main draw for me has just been like find out what's new. And I was kind of worried, like every time I saw the trailer, I was like, okay, I'm sold in this game, sure, whatever. But what's new? Like I did the guide for Breath of the Wild, so I know an uncomfortable amount of details about Breath of the Wild's map. I'm like, is it going to be the same thing over again? I don't know. Like, I've been to Kakariko Village. I've gone to Hateno Village. I know these places. Somehow this game made everything feel new. Like I didn't know anything at all. I was just like, whoa, wait, was that always there?
Yeah.
Why is this path over here now? The Dueling Peak Stable. Now there's this giant rock in the river. I can't take my horse there.
The way they remix the villages, has been really cool to see.
I just love how it constantly changes your perception of what you thought you knew. And the game takes clever ways to make you go different paths that maybe you didn't really explore the last time, but now they're definitely different.
Yeah. Yeah. I run into this all the time. I'm a little older, so my memory may not be as good as the kids out there, but I'll be in a corner of the map and I say out loud, wait, was that in the last game? Was I able to go into this room? And then one of my sons always goes like, no, you see that toppled statue?
Uh-huh.
That statue used to stand up in front of the doorway and you could never go into the rooms beyond. I'm like, oh, okay, cool.
I did Eventide Island because, I mean, I'm a huge Link's Awakening fan, so I had a beeline to the big island where they, you know, in the last game took away all your stuff, left you naked and afraid. And in this game, it's like completely remixed and there's all these new things to do. And then there's a quest afterwards. And it all really surprised me. And I love that they took, I don't know if any of you have found them. Brandon, I'm sure you have because you've like 100% of the game already. Crazy, man.
101, got all the bananas.
They took that idea from Eventide Island where they take your stuff away and they put it into a bunch of shrines. Mm-hmm. And they're like these microcosmic challenge versions of that concept. And they've been just so much fun. And so I think for me, like that discovery has been just really cool this time around, is just finding the familiar stuff, seeing how it's remixed, going up to the sky and seeing new things, and then going down below and being like, this is all different down here.
So the brilliant thing about that is that how they have this giant toy box that's just filled to the brim with creatures and enemies and tools and vehicle parts and like all these different types of foods and things, and they always explain what's new with each food, but at one point I kept on finding so many new ones I'm just like flipping through and ignoring what you can do with them. And then they do, when they take away your equipment that you've gotten used to, they force you to experiment with something you might not have, right? And so one of the shrines where they take away your stuff is you kill an enemy with a stick, like you got nothing, right? And they leave behind like an ice fruit or something like that. And then you go, oh, okay, let me try freezing enemies. And to some players, that may be the first time they've ever frozen an enemy. But like they do this really cool game design of like giving you a lot of stuff and then limiting yourself like carefully to make you experiment.
Did any of you do the one with like the, there's like the Roombas and you can just glue random garbage to them and they just annoy all the Zonai?
And I glued a bunch of spikes to them.
Yeah. And like I stuck a sword to the front of one of them's head and it just went up and the Zonai are like, nah, 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 and it's just getting stabbed.
The shrines seem a lot more extensive.
Yeah.
A lot more clever this time around.
I agree.
Yeah.
They were good before. I mean, obviously they were incredibly influential in playing Jedi Survivor and it's obvious that it goes, hey, you know what was really cool?
This looks familiar.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Those shrines in Breath of the Wild. I'm like, yes, please get that out of my Jedi game.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Tears of the Kingdom seems to have taken those concepts and been like, okay, let's kind of let players go wild with their creativity. And it feels like every shrine is a little bit different than just toting a ball around and putting into a slot.
Yeah.
And I hope players look for the bonus chest in each one of the shrines because, mm-hmm. and also in the temples, right? If you can't find every chest in the overworld, it's honestly not worth it. But the locations of the treasure chests in the temples are freaking smart as hell sometimes. There's like, you know, in one of the temples, there's a hole in a wall and you can see a treasure chest behind a grate on the other side.
Oh, I just
can't get to it.
Can you solve this for me? Because I got stuck on that this morning.
Yeah, okay. Spoiler for 30 seconds of fast forward if you don't want to hear it. You can use your ultra hand to almost reach the treasure chest, but you can't. So you have to take something long, like drop a spear or use an icicle, glue it to the treasure chest and lift it with the ultra hand through the hole in the wall until you reach.
That was like a moment right out of like a prison movie where like so getting the keys on the other side of the jail cell. Yeah.
And it's like, I guarantee you every player looked underneath. Can I get into the room from underneath? Is there a destructible wall? Because Zelda has taught us for decades that you can blow up a wall and get into a room. And none of that worked. And like, my son was sitting next to me. I'm like, well, there's got to be a reason for that hole in the world. And he was like, it's just a wisp of cloud. He was doing the whole like, oh no, that's just decoration. I'm like, there's no way Nintendo just puts this deck decoration in one place. There's a reason for it.
There's a lot of like, I forgot this was in the back of my fridge happening with this game, right? Where you go to cook dinner and you're like, oh yeah, I have that. Oh man, like the amount of times I've forgotten that I have a recall or ascend, I'll just be climbing up something and look up and be like, oh, I gotta just, you know, teleport it up through that thing. Like
first time I fell in the well, I'm like, how do I just get up here? Like, how do I get out? That's right.
I'm gonna say I would bet money that there's somebody listening or watching right now who's yelling at Pear, being like, that's not how I did it at all. I used something
probably.
Yeah.
But what's fun is if you don't get the treasure chest at first, when there are icicles around, when you come back later, the icicles are gone.
Oh.
And so like if you're reading a walkthrough and it's like, just use an icicle, it's like there aren't any. So then you got to improvise, right? So
I will say,
you can drop your stick on the ground, use a spear.
That's right.
Yeah. So I want to keep talking about our adventures across above and below Hyrule. I do want to get to some more specific stuff. Brennan, you have done tons and tons of side quests in this game. You've been working on the guide. I thought we'd check in with you and maybe catch up on some of the side quests that people absolutely shouldn't miss, or some of the best ones, the coolest ones, or the best rewards. There's an overwhelming amount of things to do in this game, and it is, I don't know if you're anything like me, incredibly easy to get distracted and go to follow something, and then 5 days later, you're on a completely different vision quest. Brennan, let's break down some of the cool stuff that people should do in this game on the side quest side of things.
Yeah, there's definitely a lot. And I like that Nintendo kind of subtly guides you in a path that gives you a lot of quests. Like, though, when you get the regional phenomena, like, oh, each 4 regions, they'll be like, oh, have you went to Rito Village? That place is kind of nearby. Mm. You should go there first. And it kind of guides you towards that, like, area to the northwest where you stop by the Hyrule Ridge Stable and you're like, oh, there's Impa and the Geoglyphs. Better do that quest. Oh, there's a tower up there. Let's go to the tower. Oh, wait, along the way, here's Hestu, that guy with the Korok seeds. So that's like a really good way to just follow that path, and you'll find a lot of interesting early side quests. I think before you get anything else, when you get to the Rito Village, there's a stable in front that's now a newspaper, the Clover Gazette. Become a reporter. It's insanely useful. I'm not just saying because we work at IGN and we have reporters. You should become one in the game. Because it unlocks a whole series of side quests that appear at each stable, which don't appear otherwise. If you go there otherwise, you won't see these side quests. Oh. And one of the most important ones is Great Fairy Fountains.
Oh, yes.
You can't get the quest unless you are a reporter first.
Okay.
So once you're a reporter, I always go over to the Woodland Stable, which is like north of Hyrule Castle by the Elden and the Great Forest regions. And you'll find someone talking to this traveling musical troupe. And the rules have changed for Great Fairies. You can't just give money to come out of their holes anymore. You have to play music for them with the right musician who has disappeared. And now that you have this quest line, you can start unlocking them in each of the regions that they appear by each stable.
That is immensely and good to know, considering I just keep knocking on their doors and they're like, bring a flute. And I'm like, I don't know what you want from me, lady.
It's too ugly out there.
Yeah, I definitely recommend doing those early because being able to upgrade your armor is essential in this game.
Right.
Otherwise, you could be taking massive damage towards the end of the game. And then once you get the Great Fairies and start going on the way for the main side quests, there's also some like, they're not side quests, they're main quests, but they're not like the main story, which is just surprising to me because the depth quests are hugely important. Mm. And it feels like for how big the depths are, they don't really tell you to go down there a lot, which is amazing to me.
Yeah.
But you should. So you should definitely go back to Lookout Landing, the main little town you start in when you get to the surface, because the assistant researcher Josh is like, oh, I want to go down to the depths. And the old Robbie guy goes down there. And by going down there, you get a quest to unlock the camera function for your Pora pad, and that also unlocks lots of quests that you could do otherwise. We'd be like, oh, give me a picture of, you know, a choo-choo, and I can make a paraglider skin out of it.
Yeah.
If you didn't do this quest, you wouldn't be able to do otherwise.
It also unlocks the ability to constantly open the camera instead of Ultra Hand, which is, that's one of my...
I've done that more times than I admit.
I do that way too often.
You're just pressing the wrong button.
Yes. Yeah, I think Justin said that, right? It's totally true. Even after all these hours, I still, once in a while, I'm like, oh, damn.
Yeah, I mean, up on the D-pad is ascend, right? Just keep pushing it.
The worst thing is when you're threatening to throw your favorite weapon. Oh, like, I'm gonna throw it. I'm like, Link, don't you dare.
Put it down.
Yep.
Put it down. This is a boomerang.
Mm-hmm.
I also think a lot of people are asking me, like, why are there side quests and side adventures? And for a long time, I didn't know the difference. It was really weird to me. They don't never really explain it. I think the official explanation is that side quests are kind of like one-offs, like, oh, I'm cooking a recipe. Do you have an apple? Whereas side adventures are kind of like tie-ins to other quest lines around the region. Like all the great fairy quests are side adventures. Even if you just meet like a missing drummer and like, I want 3 bee honey. Like that's a side adventure because it ties into the larger great fairy quest line. So if you find a side adventure, usually they kind of point you in the direction of other nearby quests or related quests. You should check those out because they usually unlock something really fun at the end of them. Another one, like a side adventure, is the Altano village. It's off in the southeast, I think.
Yeah.
It was the area where the dye shop. And they have a huge quest line for deciding like a mayoral campaign versus like a fashion designer and like a farmer. And by doing that, you unlock a lot of mini quests, which Brian's happy to know that you unlock pizza.
I wanted to look at very little of this game before launch, despite having to do the preview event and stuff like that. And I screened Tom's review before it went live. But I heard about the pizza and immediately was like, Brendan, show me a picture of it. And you did. And I just found tomatoes and I just got, it's like such a silly thing to get so excited about that. But like, this is one of my favorite games of all time. Pizza's the best food ever made. I cannot wait to bring those two loves together.
The lore behind why there was no pizza in Breath of the Wild is very strange and hilarious.
Oh my God, I can't wait.
I'm really glad this quest exists.
There's one really weird thing though. If you cook cheese, it becomes dubious food.
Really?
And that's just, I mean, there are millions of Swiss people who are just very, very angry here.
Yeah.
You could cook cheese, good things happen.
If you cook cheese and Tabantha wheat, you get cheesy bread, which is amazing.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Ooh,
well, that's, we'll take
that's,
that.
That's really, so like almost like a Zelda grilled cheese?
Yeah, pretty much.
We got to stop doing the show before lunchtime. It's dangerous out of here.
One last quest I want to call out, which is not spoiler. I won't give you too much details on it, but one thing I loved doing this game when I first got it in my hands was going to revisit locations that I loved previously or like iconic places. And so one of those was like, oh, what happened to the Great Plateau? It's where we started the game at Breath of the Wild. And now, and like, you know, years later, what's going on over there? So I went, and if you go to a very important location in the Great Plateau, you get a very strange quest. And it gets stranger and stranger. Okay. And it is one of the quests that have you going like, am I doing the right thing? Should I be doing this quest? And I did it. And like, it gave me so many questions that this game does not answer. And it has mysteries upon mysteries. And I love it. And I can't stop thinking about it. And the Great Plateau area itself, like, there's a lot of high level enemies now.
Right.
So it's a little dicey. But if you go around them, I recommend checking out that area.
Okay. I haven't done that yet.
Yeah, no, me neither. I, for some odd reason, I've like specifically didn't go back there because I spent so much time getting away from there in Breath of the Wild and being like, all right, sure, good, there, sure. Done that. You know, time to jump off and do something else. Yeah, that sounds awesome. Brendan, anything else?
The depths quest that I mentioned, the one that's back at Lookout Landing, you can go back to it after you beat your first temple, which I highly recommend because that gets you Link's last missing ability on your wheel.
Oh, right.
Which is a huge quality of life upgrade to get. It also unlocks a very, very fun chain of side quests that is also highly recommended and very entertaining. And then once you do that, you go back to Robbie and he's like, oh, I'm finally going back to my lab in Altano Village. And that's when you can get upgrades for your portapad, like getting the fast travel medallion that was in the DLC for the last game. And a hero's path mode, which are, you know, very, very fun to have early in this game.
I'm so excited to see all the squiggly lines all over this game on all three levels. I will add too, like a cool thing that's not necessarily a side quest, but like something I definitely recommend investigating. If you find a treasure map, chase it down, because chances are like the reward for it is really cool and the whole process to get it is a good time. I just found a treasure map in the sky the other day and it brought me all the way to the depths, which got me fighting through all sorts of evil remixed versions of familiar enemies, plus some new ones, including what are they called? Grox? Those
frogs.
Those are fun.
The toads.
Yeah, they're
light eater turds.
Yes. And after that, I opened up a treasure chest, which gave me like a really iconic Zelda helmet mask shaped thing. So
yeah, there's definitely lots of chests in the world that are just like, oh, it's a Zonite charge or it's a spear.
Yeah.
But the ones you get from old maps are always worth checking out.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Also, upgrade your battery if you waited way too long to do that, like I did.
How? How do you do that?
There's a little shop right north of the main village. If you warp to Lookout Landing and just walk like just a couple feet out the top door towards the north, towards the big castle, on the right you'll see a little like kind of rock sculpture, and you climb up there, give the robot there a bunch of your garbage, basically runs like a little Radio Shack, and then it'll give you new batteries for your hip device.
Nice. Pro tip, that quest I mentioned to go back in the depths the second time, that will also help you get more battery charges immensely.
Ooh, that's good to know.
Okay.
Amazing how overwhelming this game can feel sometimes.
Uh-huh.
Because it's so big.
Yeah.
So I feel like I'm juggling all of these mechanics in my head all the time. It's not so much that I want to quit or I'm like just completely overloaded. I think Nintendo has done a really masterful job of laying it all out for me and making it feel engaging and accessible. But there are times where I'm definitely like, this is too much. I can't.
Yeah. Yeah. It's definitely overwhelming. Like it's fascinating that I played this game for like 40 hours before doing the first temple or before upgrading my battery. I don't have that missing ability yet that, mm-hmm. Brennan mentioned, but like I've just been obsessed with this game, and I think that like the controls have clicked with me now finally. But if I jumped over to any other game and came back, both of those games would get destroyed for me for like a good 2 hours. You know when like you play a bunch of PlayStation or Xbox,
yeah.
And you turn on your Switch and
DNA
back and forward is yeah. So
and the stick sprint too.
Yeah,
pressing in the stick to sprint.
Like if I started playing Elden Ring again right now, I would like try to throw my weapons and you know ascend through the sky. I played so much last night that to get up to my bedroom, I turned off the TV and the first thing my brain said was hit ascend and you'll be right in your bed.
Dude, like the other day I was out for a walk in the woods and I was looking at boulders and like they were turning orange in my head because I was like, oh, I could just lift that boulder up.
Did you find a Korok under one?
Yeah.
It was, I follow this famous chef, Kenji Lopez, on Twitter. He's like, or on Instagram. It's like one of my favorite people to follow. And he like tweeted a picture from a dock in Seattle the other day that just had a piece of wood there. And he's like, oh, I really want to make a boat out of this or using Ultra Hand. And everyone was like, I have no idea what you're talking about.
That's so funny.
And I chimed in and I was just like, dude, last night I was taking all the dishes out of my dishwasher and I was like rotating them on an X and Y axis and I was worried if they got too close together, they'd get stuck. Like, it's Zelda brain, just like we had Tetris brain when that game first came out.
Yeah, Tony Hawk brain.
It's funny because Kenji Lopez's cookbook is all about experimentation and building things.
I know.
Right? He tests like, how do you make a burger the perfect way? Or when do you salt and season your steak and all that? So it's like, he definitely has that experimental mind. I had no idea he was into Zelda.
It totally made my day. If you don't want to make dubious food in real life, check out his cookbooks.
That's so good.
Brennan, thank you so much for breaking down all that. Remember, IGN has the most comprehensive, incredibly detailed, and super helpful guide on the entire internet for this game right now. It is
exhaustive.
Yeah, just I mean, the amount of people on the IGN staff that pivoted to work on this thing is just incredible. More and more Korok seeds pop up every single day. We have an interactive map. We have walkthroughs, cheats, tips, everything. Like, there's an item duplication glitch, how to get the most rupees,
We even have we launched an experimental tracking system into the guide too that I don't think many people have noticed yet that's going to get built out. So
sweet.
Hopefully people like that. And like, kudos to the guide team. They put spoiler tags everywhere. You can like expand certain things and they're hidden by default. Like, it's really thoughtful. And then we got one more tool that we're working out that's going to roll out soon.
Oh boy.
Yeah.
If you like IGN maps, I think you'll like this one too.
Who doesn't like IGN maps?
Right?
You guys launched with like 1,500 markers on day one. That was insane.
I don't know. Seriously, like if you're stuck in any single part of this game or you want to get better at it, even like Casey's thing last week, breaking down like stuff to do first.
Super
helpful. It's very easy to miss the pants. Yeah. Everybody missed the pants.
You missed the pants.
Just this morning, missed my pants.
Mm-hmm.
I heard people talking like, or I didn't hear. I saw people talking about how they're like, oh, I was in 10 hours without the paraglider, just like flipping around and like just not even realizing that that was a thing that you needed to go get.
So, yeah.
But personally, I'm being very precious about certain things. Like I know there's a limited amount of temples, so I don't want to do them.
Me too.
Like I'm like, I know I need to go there, but I'm just gonna go this way. It's cool.
Yeah. Yeah. I was also like this, you know, being on a sort of golden path is distracting me from just the sheer, you know, nature walk aspect that I have going on right now. I'm just loving, like, I don't know how you all are playing this game, but it's been interesting talking to friends who are all like approaching it differently. Like personally, I did like the closest tower and then unlocked all of the towers counterclockwise. Yeah. So I had fast travel points all over the game and then had a couple of shrines around each one. So I basically had the entire map unlocked before I did anything like really major. Then I dumped some points into stamina early on. So, cause I know that like that's really important for climbing towers, for getting over mountains, getting the shrines and stuff like that. And once I felt good with that, I started dumping some stuff into hearts. And now I feel like I'm in a good spot.
Can I say something about the towers?
Yeah.
Like a lot of, obviously, this is a game system that I think everybody credits Ubisoft with creating. Like the sort of like you unlock the map by finding this one point and it fills everything in, right? Obviously, Wind Waker did this sort of stuff. It was just a fish. It was a little different. But what I really like about the game is, I'm sure the designers at Ubisoft struggle with this and will admit this too. What happened though with certain games like Far Cry is that those quests became rote. They just became the equivalent of a fetch quest. Find a thing, climb it, turn on the computer, and the map gets filled in. And then what Zelda does now is like, you climb the tower, you get this really cool, rewarding cutscene that's unlike any other tower unlock that I've seen. Then you go to the second tower and you go, the door is locked.
Yeah.
You go like, or the door is open and you touch the touchpad doesn't work, right? Like they constantly do this sort of like, oh, I know what to do, and they
I have to say, for the towers things, one thing that keeps popping up that I did not think would happen is there's one tower where this guy is like, oh, I can't get in, maybe I'll go get some mushrooms in a cave.
Oh yeah.
And everyone's like, I got all these mushrooms and you won't eat them. Like, no, you ascend through the cave.
Yeah.
Oh, so if you're wondering, don't give the guy mushrooms. He's fine.
Just, one of the things.
There's other ways to get there.
I think that being launched into the sky by those towers is one of the coolest moments I've had
in the game
in quite a while. It feels like Nintendo styling, just being like, you thought that the towers of Breath of the Wild were cool? Have a look at this.
Tom Marks, who reviewed the game for us, had an idea in the office the other day, which he then recorded and we published, which is like flying from the highest point in the game to the lowest point in the game. And he launched up to, there's a part in the sky where the game just goes stop.
Yeah,
that's enough.
3,300.
Yeah, 3,300. Yeah. And then he did that, and I guess over Gerudo, there's a hole to the depths, and he went all the way from up there, all the way down to the bottom, and it's like basically seamless. Yeah. And
it's No Man's Sky.
Yeah, there's stuff happening. I am not a video game programmer. I do not even begin to understand how that world works. But there is stuff that is happening in this game that I just look at and I'm like, I don't know how they're pulling this off.
I know a programmer who's worked on a number of open world games. Mm-hmm. And she was pretty scoffing pretty hard at Scarlet and Violet, I have to say.
Yeah.
At Tears of the Kingdom, she's like, I am in awe of this game.
Yeah.
I don't know how they did this. Yep. It's incredible.
The LOD management where they're kind of, you know, they're simplifying objects when they get farther away from the camera. I actually think it's so good that the game looks at its best when you're at the highest point. Like when you're up in the sky and you look at the world, it's freaking gorgeous.
It's
so good.
Yeah.
It's like when you're getting closer to things sometimes, especially with all the grass and the effects going on, that's when it struggles a bit, clearly. But yeah, like sure. the, just the, you know, what you're describing there's a point to the towers after you use them for the first time. When you use them for the first time, you're tethered.
Yeah.
You see this like data exchange animation. It's really cool. But unlike the UB towers, which are then worthless, you can still use these to fast travel and launch yourself from, and you get height and you use it as shortcuts. Which
I love it.
Like.
I love it so much.
Yeah. Also, just zooming in with your pad when you're in like midair, it'll pause your descent while you look around and scope the area.
I love doing that and like tagging a location, and doing that with your camera or with your pad is so much more fun than just like clicking an icon on a map. Like that's every other open world game is like that, and I know Breath of the Wild did this too, but it's just, it's such a rewarding feeling. God, Tom has so many hearts. I'm envious.
By the way, for people who haven't seen this video, which is everyone, I think it took 3.5 minutes for him to go from the highest point to the lowest point. And he only used the paraglider at the last like possible second,
so right,
it's bananas.
We made it.
I'm still in awe of the verticality, because like you mentioned, like the he got to like 3,300 like meters up. When you shoot out of a tower, you're at about 1,000,
right?
So the amount of sky you can still traverse after getting out of a like a sky view tower is huge. You can like get to a place and go like, oh, is that a dragon flying down there? Why is it so far down? And the ground looks, it was so far up, but actually they're pretty close to the ground.
Yeah.
I will say the thing that makes me the angriest in this game so far, outside of little red jazz hands coming after me, is are the pilot wings challenges where you're diving through the ring.
Oh, yeah.
You want to beat that like 25 seconds.
Yep.
And like I will land always with 25.2 seconds. And like it's super fun, but it's also, it's, you know.
You got to dive.
Yeah. No, of course, but
smack into a wall.
Now, Seth, I think like one of the best parts of Breath of the Wild was seeing people break the game in like very wild and creative ways. And it seems, and I think like the running theme that we've had in conversations and Talk of the Kingdom has been how Nintendo sort of took all the ideas that people were doing illegally and they legalized them for Tears of the Kingdom, right? You know,
decriminalized.
And it's been fascinating. I think even like 2 days after this game came out, watching people make things in this game that I didn't think were possible. So help us break down some of the coolest and craziest things that the community has made so far. And for those listening at home, we will do our best to describe them. You just picture just some of the silliest and weirdest vehicles you can possibly imagine. But if for those watching, we'll take a look at them today. So Seth, what do we got?
All right, yeah, try to paint a picture in your mind's eye of some of these if you are just listening. But the first one is the big wheel. And the big wheel is, any guesses as to
picture what? In your mind, a big
picture
wheel.
In your mind.
Is it a
big wheel?
Is it
a platform?
Wheel, big wheel.
Is it a monster truck or is it like?
No, it's a single, it's like, imagine if you took a Ferris wheel and you put a platform on it and just drove around on it. Yeah, look at how cool that thing is.
And so this thing goes on land and water. It looks like it should explode at any moment.
It's like the Ferris wheel scene from that bad Spielberg movie.
Yeah. Well, I don't know what that is, but I know I feel like I have to check it out.
1941,
it's like one half of that guy from Twisted Metal who has two giant wheels he's strapped to.
Yeah, it's... I don't understand.
Oh, he's got the balancer thing, right?
It's a stabilizer in the middle platform, so it always stays upright.
So it's like a Ferris wheel that runs by itself and it has a little side platform like some
gets stuck in trees.
Yes, and this has inspired me. Once I get a little bit more into the game, I'm going to make a giant penny far thing for my Link to ride around on with his monocle.
That's great.
Yeah, that's the big wheel. Then we also have
I
like this one because somebody on Reddit was very proud of it, but it's Va Ruta. They made their own, but it's very much the we got Va Ruta at home energy because it is it's like some squares and some other cubes.
Divine beast.
Just a little fire hydrant on his nose.
Oh, they made made a little elephant.
Yeah, they made a little elephant. And look at this shooting at water, just like Va Ruta.
Fire hydrant nose.
It's an elephant.
See, the dungeons are incredible in this game.
Yeah,
it's an elephant with wagon wheel eyes and a water squirting trunk.
I didn't know there was a fire hydrant zoni.
Wait, what?
Go in the sky.
There's a whole there's a whole section of the game that's just Mario Sunshine. But a lot of people were really upset that you can't pet the dogs again in this one. So somebody built a fantabulous dog petting contraption that automates petting the dog. So Link can't do it, but what Link can do is build this crazy Rube Goldberg-esque contraption that just pets the dog.
Like pistons and everything.
It's I don't know exactly what the pieces are there, but on the end is a wagon wheel, and it's just going out and it's petting the pup. And look at that, he's loving it.
I saw someone put a skeleton arm on one, so it's like, oh, it's technically it's petting.
That's actually a better idea.
Is
yeah,
the dog being pet? Is it happy?
No.
Some hearts come out of it at some point.
It's
right?
being pushed. But
I mean,
look, oh, there you go. It's happy.
It's that's a happy pet. Dog.
I love it. Like, what can you pet the dog? No, is one of the only times this game says no to anything, and people were like, "Well, I'll be the judge of that."
Yeah, yeah right.
Well, to be fair though, as a owner of dogs, I can tell you Link's method of just dropping steaks probably is something they prefer.
Oh yeah. You don't own dogs, Perry. You own horses. The house horses,
meat eating horses.
They're carnivorous horses. Yes.
Ho ho! I have to say to them, otherwise they run.
Ho ho. This is amazing.
All right, this is probably one of the like most prolific creators out there. It's this guy on TikTok, Soul Banana Zero, and I mean, I'm gonna get to probably my favorite creation by this person, but you just go to their TikTok and they're making mechs, basically, like huge ridiculous mechs that run all over the damn place that do all kinds of crazy things that don't seem possible. I don't understand how they're being built because it's a little bit more detailed than the elephant. Like, well, this isn't it, but this is one of their traps. They built a trap for all this Bokoblin tribe that just
shoots.
It's the Kowloon God fire trap, and it just scorches them in the most horrible, horrible possible way. And this is and then there's this weird like light device that blinds everything. This is absolutely the TikTok. So, I might reinstall TikTok.
I've unlocked the
imagine getting high beam by every car in existence.
Yeah,
I've unlocked the spotlight zone eye things, and I always wondered like, all right, man, these are good in the depths and stuff like that. If you want to mess around a little bit and see more down there, but I didn't think to drive around the open world and just bother people with them. Yeah. You know, just shoot them right in people's eyes. That's ridiculous.
Somebody made a VF Valkyrie. Speaking of mechs,
I did see that.
Lacross.
Oh my god!
Oh, that was the one I was gonna end with. Yeah, because I thought that was the best one.
Oh yeah,
It was actually that that Twitter user Soul Banana who did it, and then made it with the Macross Frontier. Yeah. I mean, we'd get like a content match, but made the music from the anime.
Oh, this one's a little different than the one that I saw. Like,
yeah, this one's different.
There's in the sky shooting lasers and everything.
Yeah, so this is straight up like a roller skating mech.
Yeah.
With swinging arms.
And lasers.
And lasers and fire.
Wow. Missiles. Yeah, it's crazy.
He uses the sled for the shield for the front.
Not what the Bokoblin signed up for. Like they did not had no idea this was happening.
One
of my friends was saying, "You think Armored Core is going to beat Tears of the Kingdom?" I'm like, well, I can play Armored Core and Tears of the Kingdom. So.
Someone built Armored Core and Tears of the Kingdom, basically.
Do we know if there's a limitation? Like, is there a point where the game is like, stop, please? You can't glue anything else to this thing?
I haven't hit it.
Oh my god!
I've done like the long bridges thing that we joked about.
Yep.
I've done that where I went. You were supposed to throw chestnuts into a fire, and I of course didn't talk to the NPC, so I just made the longest bridge ever. And I kept on stacking logs together, and I'm like, is this game gonna say no? And like, no, the game didn't say no.
When you make, there's been a lot of discussion in the last week about the long bridges. It's been like a whole thing on the internet. When you make those really long bridges, like just by gluing things together until it's, the size of a football field, and then you use Ultra Hand to pick it up, it feels like everything should break. You're swinging this like very long, precarious thing, and it works.
They actually simulate it bends in the middle. When it gets really long, it bends. So like the physics calculations on it, really impressive.
How funny is it when you make one of those and you go to reach across and it falls
it's not funny at all.
No, and you have to rebuild the whole thing.
It's the same.
Can you recall it back up?
Yeah.
We've all done it, right? By the way, great example of a game design. When you build your first sail raft, I think most people will accidentally send that raft off without them.
Yeah.
And there's just enough pieces nearby to make a second one. Mm-hmm. And that's, you know, Nintendo started with just enough pieces for one. And then always people go like, oh no, there it goes.
Yeah.
Where the QA testing was.
That's so good.
In the depths, I'm constantly building things that just crash and explode or get stuck in the
mud. Well, the worst is
the mud.
If you use an axe or something to activate your Zonai devices and you destroy your entire.
Yeah. I mean, that's.
What, always use arrows.
Yeah. Use arrows. Yeah. That's such a good tip, Brendan. I think you put that in one of our Slack channels the other day. And like, You changed destiny for me because the amount of videos out there on the internet of somebody painstakingly building something with Ultra Hand and then they get onto it and they smack it with something and it just explodes into smithereens is so funny. I mentioned it, Tom mentioned his review, Wile E. Coyote, Looney Tunes, just constantly happening in this game. It's been great to see.
So good.
Here's the thing, though. People are not just using this creativity for good. The Zelda's community creativity is being extended to destruction, to evil, specifically destroying the peaceful tranquility and sanity of the Korok species. That's right. People are creating elaborate torture devices for Koroks. And I wanted to check in with all of you to see how we feel about that ethically, morally, emotionally. Brendan, let's start with you. You've played this game a lot. I feel like you've had maybe the most sympathy whittled away from you when it comes to finding them, interacting with them. I assume you got them all in the last game and was hand-delivered a golden poop from Hestu as his gift.
You can see my villain origin story building up from there.
Yeah, exactly. What is your stance on Korok torture?
There are levels that I've seen that I have not risen to. And I'm fully expecting to go to like the great Deku tree in the forest and be like, you know, get out.
Yep.
You're persona non grata. Just leave, please.
It's like, I saw what you did.
Yeah. I think it started with the first one. The first one that needs to help find his friend in the sky island. You just like ram across the rails into his face.
Yeah.
But I've had some interesting opportunities to have fun. And the one that I think about the most wasn't really, okay, I'll let you decide whether this was, you know, just a simple Uber service or kidnapping. At one point when I was by a stable and I was like, I saw another Korok. I was like, oh, I need help find my friend. And I'm like, what's the limit of where I can take him to? What if I just take him somewhere else? So I took out my horse from the stable. I attached a towing harness. And I got a wagon nearby in the stable to attach to. And I'm like, all right, you come with me. So he's like, find my friend. I'm like, no, you're going to go in the wagon. We're going to go on a little ride. Don't worry. It's on the way. So we head out from, I think it was like Dueling Peak Stable. I go over the bridge and bump, bump, bump. He's like falling off the back. I put him back in. I didn't want to glue him in because I just like to see him bounce around.
Uh-huh.
And he's screaming the entire time, I need to find my friend. No, we went through Kakariko Village and down into Central Hyrule. I find another Korok. Cool, join the party. So now I have two. And we continue to go on this roundabout trip through Central Hyrule and Hyrule Field, finding more Koroks to stash into my wagon, which is now like the Koroki trail or something. And it gets to the point where I have like six or seven.
Oh my God.
And each time they'll be like, hey, we got separated. Can you help me? And I look at my wagon. It's full of people. Like, yeah, hop in. And we get to a point where a little further than this, where I was like, okay, I take a shortcut around because I want to get to like the Hyrule Ridge. So I go down through this area that's full of
Bokoblins.
And by this point in the game, I'm really late in, like past the story mode. So there's a silver Bokoblin running at me with a horse. I slam into him with my carriage. He does a backflip onto the cart behind me with all the Koroks and starts waving his spear around. I'm just like, oh my God, no. I jump out. He kills my horse on one hit. All the Koroks scatter. I'm like, all right, I'm going to reload an earlier save and try this again. I think it was this part here. Like, it's just like an amazing, like it's like a Looney Tunes moment where I'm just like, should I get out and fight? No, I can power through this. And like everything that happened was a moment that you could not recreate.
This is
it was
like how they got all the kids to the Donkey Island in Pinocchio.
I was gonna say, did you ever get to Wally World? Or
yeah,
we did eventually. So yeah, after this point, he does a backflip onto the cart and just goes crazy.
What?
And he would instantly kill me in one hit. There goes my.
Okay, so if
it was
you have to watch the footage on the show, I cannot
fathom how you did this. There's also like there's no reason to do this. You specifically disconnected them from the Koroks that were supposed to go meet and brought them together with the other Koroks. Like you took like,
so I decided to have a house party at the end. I'm like, you know, let's just go to my pad. So we went all the way up to Akala, and I was like, okay, let's get a selfie together, have a little like outdoor patio. So they're all screaming in the back of my car the entire time. It's like it's starting to make the game stutter.
So early,
because they're all yelling at once
earlier in the show,
and then eventually I get a cool little selfie with them, turn into a painting in my house. It's my little adventure.
Early in the show, you said you've done everything and nothing in this game, and I'm glad we got to the part where you did nothing, because this is there's nothing. I guess there is something productive because you put no one else has this photo, right? It's in your home now.
This is like Heart of Darkness, man. I don't know, Brendan, what happened to you and
I. I didn't know you were going
to
tell that story.
We're on the way to their friend, okay? We just made some stops.
I was not expecting any of that. I'm floored right now.
I think so many games would be...
Yeah.
If you tried to do that, you'd get away from a certain point, and then they'd be like, hey, my friend's over there, and then they would like warp back or something.
Well, yeah, I was waiting for
that
moment to
carry them around for so long.
One of my favorite gameplay videos from like the last probably decade is there was somebody playing Red Dead Redemption 2 who tried to see if they could carry a bowl of soup across the entire map. And there's all these different things that get in the way while you're holding the soup and stop it, and it can force it to like despawn from your hand. If you bump into anything, there's an NPC that can bother you and the soup disappears. So he was just like, whoa, carrying the soup across the entire map. And in Tears of the Kingdom, you can just steal a bunch of Koroks, put them in the truck and drive around all day. What?
Imagine if you roll up to Gandalf at the end going like, hey, here's my Korok army. They're looking for their friend. It's you.
Yeah. Yeah. That's not what they signed up for, Brendan. They did not want to do that. Seth.
Maybe I was the friend they were looking for.
Seth, we've seen video. One of my favorite ones, is there's a video of a bunch of like six or seven Koroks on a like rotisserie, and they're just rotating over open fires, and they're just like, help, help, help. And I want to point out that all of us tortured Koroks a little bit, if only by accident, in Breath of the Wild. You pick up the rock, yes. The Korok goes, yah ha ha, and you drop the rock by accident or on purpose, and he goes, hah! Yeah. And it makes that noise. So we've all done it, you know? We've all done some mild bludgeoning. What's your stance on Korok torture?
I am, it's weird because I'm against it.
Okay. That's not weird, by the way.
Well, no. I have to tell you why it's weird. I'm against it, but when I see a little Korok squirming around saying, my friend's over there, I'm like, come on, really? Like, I don't want to deal with these guys. And it's because I am a dog owner. And those one, they remind me of what a tick looks like when it's full of blood and it's squirming around and it's super disgusting to me. And I don't want to deal with them, or I do deal with them. And it's the same way, like, well, speaking of dog, like when you pick up a little dog mess, you're like, get out of here. So I'm against it. I always felt bad when I would drop the rock on their head. And I'm not going to try to like make their lives any more disgusting.
Any more disgusting. Yeah.
Yeah. So okay. Now that I've said that they look like fully exploded ticks, now everyone will see that.
The moment I realized that you could pick up the backpack ones with Ultra Hand and stick them to things, I was like, it's over for them. Like I'm not doing this. I don't have interest in doing this. But I knew immediately the internet was going to destroy these little things.
Yeah.
Pear, what about you?
You think the guy who designed it lives in fear of what he's created?
Yeah. I honestly feel bad.
I
feel bad for them. And like, yeah, they did set it up as, hey, don't worry, these are indestructible, right? Like in the first game, when you drop the rock on them, they're like, man, they can take it.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, this game takes it to the new level. And like they knew, because of the way the game is set up, that, you know, there's like a Korok saying, I want to go over there. And there's building materials next to it. And
yeah,
then sometimes the building materials get a little powerful.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And the stuff you carry, obviously. And so I think everybody's going to do the rocket thing.
Yeah, I think the rocket thing's okay. I think building a rotisserie is, you know...
The rotisserie, like, I was excessive. Like, oh, God, boy.
Mm-hmm.
I've got some problems.
I mean, I want to start by asking, I'm really curious about how all of this came to be, because I know that developers were absolutely trying it out on their own and mm-hmm. probably having a lot of fun. I'm sure they were testing things out, messing around with it and everything. And
That's why I kept getting delayed.
So, probably. I think that Korok Torture probably added at least a year to this game. The thing that I find interesting, so Tears of the Kingdom sold 10 million copies in 3 days.
Uh-huh.
It's just an astonishing number, especially for a Zelda game. And our social media head, Bob Marshall, it was interesting. He said that actually Tears of the Kingdom wasn't hitting particularly hard for IGN video. And his thesis was that the kids weren't that interested
right.
in Tears of the Kingdom going in on TikTok and Insta. But the second that they started, they learned about all the crazy things that you could do, including the Korok torture. Yeah. They were like, aha. And I think that Korok torture is a key part of why this game is so successful, because memification isn't necessary to be a success, but it can sure supercharge
yes.
it.
Yes.
Minecraft yeah. and Roblox, right? Both have seen that sort of effect. And like Minecraft, it took years for somebody to build a working calculator using redstone pieces in the game. And like, yeah. we know Zelda is just gonna get crazier and crazier.
Just to illustrate how much the building aspects of Tears of the Kingdom has caught the collective video game internet or community by surprise. Did you know that a week after Tears of the Kingdom came out, a Lego video game was released? Does anybody know that? Lego 2K Drive came out. That came out this week. You can build your own vehicles in it and drive them around like Lego, like you love to do. No one knows that happened because
you played it yet?
No, because I'm building vehicles in Zelda, which I never thought they've been trying to perfect that like building mechanism in Lego video games for ages, and Nintendo just did it here. In their own weird way, and people are mostly using it to kill cute little woodland animals and stuff like that, or rotisserie them. But still,
I think a wild point to clarify is that like all the meme videos and all the building stuff, people are like, I see comments going like, "Oh, why is Zelda Fortnite now?" Like, Zelda is still very much Zelda.
Yeah.
Like, I went through the main story barely building anything.
Mm-hmm.
There are certain points where it's like, "Oh, you should really build like a minecart with like a little thing or a small wing glider," but by and large, you can do most of this game's story and a lot of its side quests without doing that much building.
No.
Like, it's just a side thing, and it's so huge.
It's compelling.
Also so
it
optional.
Just shows the number of options.
Yeah.
It is compelling to put, you know, like a rocket on the back of a minecart or something mm-hmm. like that and be like, oh, I could do that. That's cool. Or to be able to solve a problem. And then you can dig so much more deeply if you want. That said, screw the Koroks. They can all burn. I thought that quest in Breath of the Wild was terrible for the most part. So I'm delighted to watch them finally get their comeuppance after giving all these poor, poor lost souls who spend all of their time looking for seeds, giving them golden poops.
Yeah.
You get what you deserve, my friends.
That's been the number one justification I've heard for Korok torture is Hestu's gift, the golden poop that they give you at the end of that game. And the smaller poops.
Just strap rocket to Hestu next.
It's karma.
Send him to space.
Oh, he's DOA. They're coming for him next. I don't even know what they're gonna do to that guy. Poor guy. Speaking of collecting hundreds of useless things, Pear.
Oh, what?
No.
What are you talking about?
You own every amiibo ever made, 206 of them so far, many of which have appeared on this desk throughout the duration of the show. They are multiplying. If you didn't have your life together in nearly every other category, I would be slightly worried about you. Amiibo support is actually pretty awesome in Tears of the Kingdom. Probably more so than any Nintendo game we've seen in a while. So I figured we could talk a bit about what your experience has been like with Amiibo and just how you like the Amiibo support in general.
What has my experience been with? Well, I think there are 29 Zelda amiibo on this desk right now.
Is that how many have been released?
There are a lot of them. There's not a Korok, which is that's a mistake.
Oh,
though people would probably light him on fire.
Yeah, we'll think of a self-immolating Korok amiibo. Yeah.
I mean, we got a freaking Bubble Klein, right? Is that
I know? Yeah, the Bubble Kleins are back.
No, I mean the integration is pretty good. Like you can use your Zelda amiibo to unlock things, but they're not locked behind these figures as DLC, right? Everything you can unlock with them can be found in the game the organic way as well, but it sure is a nice shortcut. So each one of them, when you scan them, it'll drop items from the sky and a treasure chest. Mm-hmm. And
there's a random element to it. What you get some armor based on classic franchises. You get patterns for your glider,
which I really like. I think that's a really cool addition this time around.
Yeah, so you know your Wind Waker Link will unlock the you know the King of Red Lions pattern for your glider that you you know take to town and have it printed on it. And what is nice is you can stock up on items. You can use them once a day to you know make it rain and stock up on items. So like certain sort of fish or you know ingredients or you know like this bad boy will drop metal boxes from the sky.
Oh right,
can be a nice surprise to rain on your enemies as well.
Yeah,
so you know they're fun ways to like play with these. But I gotta say, it is a chore.
It is. It is a chore. Yeah.
When you smog and you sit on this horde of
You don't have
amiibo,
to scan them all.
I have to
every
scan
day.
Them. No.
Okay.
Every day.
That is. I mean, that is the quest I undertook. I have to scan them.
Also,
have you timed yourself doing it?
For those of you who did some filthy, dirty time traveling in Animal Crossing, you'll be excited to know that if you go into your system settings and you change the clock on your Switch to the next day.
Yep.
Fun little cheat code. You can scan them all over again. So I've heard.
Hey, know what? I have another little cheat code that I discovered yesterday. I ordered the Ocarina of Time reprint and it arrived yesterday and I tore it open. They don't put that little piece of foil in the bottom to block the NFC anymore.
Oh.
So yeah, I could have scanned it through the box and not have had to have opened it and therefore ruined its collectible value.
It's funny that they had that to begin with because that implies that people were like sneaking their Wii U gamepads into, you know,
into
Best Buy.
And, like,
yeah.
I know we had a moment here in the office where I'd brought in all the amiibo I thought, but one of my kids had ganked one from the shelf and I didn't know. And like Sam is like,
by one of your kids, do you mean somebody who works here?
No, at home. I hope you guys aren't in my house. Are you in my house?
No.
And Sam said, where's the bird? And I'm like, oh crap, I don't have the bird. And he goes, I have the bird, but it's in its original box. And I'm like, well, you got to open it. He's like, he wouldn't. He didn't open it, and it did have that little metal thing that shielded it. We tried everything to scan it, so no.
I tweeted this out, but like I had the Link's Awakening amiibo is my favorite one, not only because I love the design on it, but it's got this like really cool kind of sheen to it, you know? It's got like a shininess.
Cartoonish.
And that one works in this game, and I scanned it, and I got the Tunic of Awakening, and then I got the Trousers of Awakening, which is an odd phrase, but then I got the helmet hat.
It's the Mask of Awakening.
The Mask of Awakening, which if you haven't seen, I will not spoil, but I will say that it looks like nothing else in the rest of the game. It is incredibly silly. It has animated hair, but its face stays exactly the same. So in like deep, introspective, beautiful cutscenes, you just have this face that is not matching the tone of the room, and it's very, very, very funny.
That's neat. And they, you know, some of the random rewards are weapons from another age where they're not decayed. You know, you get clean weapons. I think you can probably talk to some likes to do that too. You get clean weapons from some of these, and then the only sad thing is Midna and Wolf Link will not spawn a wolf. That would have been the ultimate reward, like in Twilight Princess. But
they do
give you the best paraglider outfit.
Give you that, and they also give you a ton of meat. And I kept swiping that amiibo or scanning it to try and get the wolf or try to get something. And I realized like 20 hours into the game, I had like 700 steaks. Just walking around. So every time I was hungry in a battle, just eat 15, 20 steaks.
You can scan.
I exclusively use the paraglider from the Wolf Link because it's the Mirror of Twilight and it glows in the dark, which is the coolest one.
The ultimate, I mean, fulfilling the promise of amiibo would, of course, be that you get something unique for each one of them, whether it's Zelda or not. And like Mario Maker, I think, was the one game that did that, where you got all the little characters. And obviously, that was maybe a little bit more doable because they only had to do 2D sprites instead of modeling stuff.
They didn't have 206 amiibo at the time.
But yeah, I mean, it's
you
it's
did.
Still, yeah, that's right. It's still, well, there were a lot, though. That
there
game
were a lot.
Unlocked, there were a lot of unlocks in that. But
no,
I do appreciate from Breath of the Wild, where people were kind of had the FOMO of like, oh, I can't get the classic Link tunic if I don't have the amiibo. And this, you can still find all the amiibo armor and the weapons in the world. Yeah. If you explore deep enough to find them, the only things you can't get, I think, are the paraglider skins, which are just cosmetic.
Yeah.
And even like getting Epona from the Twilight Princess Link is like, yeah, you get Epona early and that's great, but you can't upgrade Epona or you can't like customize Epona. It's just Epona the horse with set stats.
Yeah.
Other horses you find, you can eventually get them to be as good or better than Epona.
In terms of unlocking costumes and stuff like that without amiibo, I will say that when you're in the depths and you see Poe's, those little blue lights, collect as many of them as you can constantly, because they will come in handy later on. And finally, I got out of the game a very long time ago. Per, you're committed. Old school NVC fans will remember during the Wii U era when we didn't have games to talk about. We mostly talked about bothering Target employees at 7:30 in the morning to see if Rosalina was there yet. We didn't have a lot going on. But I will say I did buy the brand new Tears of the Kingdom amiibo, and it's gorgeous. It's like they still has a little ice blocks on his feet. I don't know why. You know, it's better than the pea stick he had on the first one. You know, the first Link one had that yellow rectangle. It's a really beautiful amiibo, and it was cool to get one of those again for the first time in a very long time.
For sure.
Yeah.
I wasn't even intending to buy it, but I went to a pre-launch party, and I picked up the game, and they're like, here, have the amiibo too. And I'm like, but sure, why not?
Oh, yeah.
And then as soon as I got home, I'm like, this is actually a really good amiibo.
Yeah.
I'm happy to have this one. All the Zelda... A lot of the Zelda amiibos are really good.
They got better. I mean, like, look at the more recent ones, you know.
Very
Zelda and her toucan are also really nice.
Her toucan.
but they honestly, like, if you go back, like, where's the early Link is the one with the pea stand, the yellow stand.
Yeah.
Right? And, like, you hear, and you see, you know, how much more sophisticated they've become with, you know, pulling off the pose without many, like... bars and things. It's just bars.
What was the Captain Falcon one where he's like there's just like a stick under his foot holding his leg up.
I mean,
that's
also not the
good.
Early designs had like the face of like the ice cream melted off of them. Okay.
I was looking at I did the same thing as you, Pear. I picked up my Smash Brothers Link amiibo, which was one of the first amiibo they ever launched, right? It was in that first wave. Yeah. And I put it next to I put it next to the Tears of the Kingdom one. And the Smash Brothers one is really funny because there was a thing with those where like 50% of them had eyes that were just completely mismatched.
Oh, yeah.
Like looking in totally different directions. So he's got this serious pose and then he's just got the goofiest face.
Yep.
Yeah. But yeah, that's the amiibo support so far in Tears of the Kingdom. Like we said, everything there you can still unlock doing just regular gameplay, which has been really fun. But yeah, I just love talking about this game. I wanted to check in with all of you before we go just about like some of our favorite moments that we've had so far playing Tears of the Kingdom. We'll stay away from spoiler-free stuff, but kind of like, you know, things that have been like really funny or really interesting or really charming, really caught you off guard. Kat, let's start with you.
I was running down a canyon trying to get to the Rito village.
Uh-huh.
And I came across a pile of stuff, including the glider for the first time.
Oh.
I had no idea how the actual glider worked, but there were rockets. And I had remembered that somebody built a multi-stage rocket in Tears of the Kingdom. I'm like, well, maybe I should just attach the rockets to the glider. I didn't think about adding an engine to the glider. So I was able to kind of cobble together a few different things. I cobbled together a little car, cobbled together a glider and with rockets and a stick. And then I launched and I went into the air and I was like, aha, freedom. I did it at last. And then the rockets went pew. And then totally flew off and flew away into the horizon. I didn't know where they went. And my poor little glider just started going, eh. I was just like, alas. But it was a good lesson in how to actually do things. And then I discovered that you could do the rewind trick to
Watch
yourself. You don't need the rockets to get up into the air.
So. I have put rockets on backwards way too many times.
Also, like, on the opening tutorial island, I figured out that I could do the floating platform all the way back.
Right.
Just over the entire island. And I felt so smart, even though I figured that they probably put it there for that exact reason.
Per, what about you?
I had forgotten that I had the recall ability for a good portion of the game.
You know, obviously when you're in the overworld, like for traversal, like getting yourself up in the sky, it's just indispensable now. But like in the beginning, I didn't. And I went to my first temple and I was standing, I'm not going to say which one it is, but like I was standing on a platform and a cannon shot a giant freaking bullet bill at me. And it was about to impact with me and I hit the shoulder button. And I selected recall, and I selected the cannonball, and it flew back and destroyed the cannon. I'm like, what? Does anybody know this exists? Does anybody know this works? Like those moments where you have this discovery where you feel like there are a million ways to solve this, and probably the best thing would be to just jump away and run away. And like just to kind of stumble upon that was just really
mm-hmm. Seth, what about you?
I was loving this game a lot, but I still wasn't loving it more than Breath of the Wild until I did my first dungeon. And I had heard that, oh, well, the dungeons are different. You know, you don't find the iron boots to sink to the bottom. You don't find like the hook shot to swing across gaps, you know, blah, blah, blah. And so I went into this dungeon with that sort of mindset that I was like, this isn't going to be a classic. But I was wrong. And everyone who said that is an idiot because it is a classic Zelda dungeon that is using the Tears of the Kingdom like gameplay mechanics. Mm-hmm. And it was so awesome and so fun and so rewarding. I never got frustrated. There was never a time where I was like, I don't know what I'm doing here. And it was just like discovery after discovery. And then like I felt super smart when I figured something out. I was like, of course I use this power that I have now to do this thing right here. And then I was like, okay, this is now my favorite game of all time.
Awesome. Brennan, what about you?
It's a lot to talk about, but I'll probably focus on something early. Like the first time going to the depths is such like an eye-opener experience. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And going like, where am I supposed to go? Like everything's so dark. Where am I allowed to travel? And the early part where I'm like trying to get away because the gloom and it's everywhere. How am I going to get across? I look over to my right and there is a skeleton horse just chilling. And I'm like, oh, can I ride that? Will it work on the gloom? And it lets you go over the gloom with no, you know, bad effects happening. So I just found my new horse and we were just running across the dark plains of this weird underground world. And I'm just like, how do they fit all this under here? I couldn't believe it. It was such a cool experience.
It just keeps
to
going.
Find this stuff on my own and go like off exploring in random directions.
Yeah, I can't even fathom that because Tom tipped me off on that. So you played it before launch. That would have blown my mind. Ladies and gentlemen, that is just about all the time we have for this week's very special Zelda episode of Nintendo Voice Chat. Be sure to come back every Thursday as we skydive into gameplay tips, secrets, all that fun stuff, adventures. We've got everything. And plus our stories as we explore the vast world of Hyrule. The game is out there in the wild. I'm loving watching people break it and hurt Koroks in strange and bizarre ways. Remember, we've got a few more episodes left of Talk of the Kingdom. It's available on all your favorite podcast platforms. It's on IGN, YouTube, everywhere you get your shows. If you're watching us on YouTube, leave us a like and a nice comment. If you're listening on a podcast app, leave us a review. Do not forget to follow Nintendo Voice Chat on Twitter. Oh, and if you like the Zelda shirt I'm wearing, check out the IGN store. We've got a ton of awesome Zelda and Tears of the Kingdom shirts up there right now. If you love the world's saltiest licorice that tastes like the depths, check out Paris' German hometown of Lingelsberg. It's a beautiful place. Paris was raised exclusively on salted Lingelsberg. Lingelsberg, Germany.
Is this real?
Yeah, in Germany.
Is this echt?
And they have salty licorice there?
I'm sorry. Did I blow up your spot?
I'm going.
Everyone's going
to
fly
there. Can I fuse it to a weapon?
Commit to the bit.
Yeah, if you guys like horrible candy that tastes like the sea, you got to go check out Lingelsberg. Anyway, thanks for watching and listening to Talk at the Kingdom. No one knew that was coming. We'll see you next week. And remember that NVC is the only place where you can...
The tingle.
Get the tingle.
Nice.
I should have warned you about that.
Is Lingelsberg real?